Good morning and welcome to Gersell Academy's annual Black History Month Assembly. My name is Jalen Blackwell and I'm excited to open today's assembly. Please stand and join me in reciting the Pledge of Allegiance. I pledge of allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. The 2024 Black History Month theme is African Americans in the Arts. As stated by the Association for the Study of African Americans' Life and History, African American art is infused with African, Caribbean, and Black American lived experiences. In the fields of visual arts, performing arts, literature, fashion, folklore, language, film, music, architecture, culinary, and other forms of cultural expression, the African American influence has been paramount. Artistic movement and cultural movements such as the Black Arts, Black Renaissance, Hip Hop, and Afrofuturism have been led by the people of African descent and have set the standard for popular trends around the world. In 2024, we have examined the varied history and the life of African American arts and artisans. In celebrating the entire history of African Americans in the arts, the Association for the Study of African American Life and History puts into the national spotlight the richness of the past and present with an eye towards what is the rest of the 21st century will bring. ASALH dedicates its 98th annual Black History Month theme to African Americans and the arts. Before we begin today's presentations with some awesome lower school performances, I would like to highlight portrait leader Louis Armstrong, world-renowned trumpeter. You may have recognized his popular song, What a Wonderful World, on your way into the gym this morning. Born in New Orleans, Louisiana, Louis joined King Oliver's Creole Band in Chicago, which was an overnight sensation. He had an impressive 48-year career. Louis popularized scat singing and led the jazz craze that swept the United States and the world. He performed in dozens of countries on every continent, to crowds sometimes over 100,000. Louis was also the first Black man in the United States to host a radio show. In 1957, Armstrong attacked segregation in America and challenged President Eisenhower to enforce the Supreme Court's desegregation order, and Eisenhower followed suit. In 1964, at the age of 63, he led the pop charts with the recording of Hello Dolly. He was the oldest person to ever do so. He even bumped the Beatles from their number one spot. Louis Armstrong won 2 Grammy Awards. Thank you for listening. Next to present are 4th grade students, Van Wah and George Liberhamanas, who will introduce our next performance.
We are the Rollers written in 1985 by Lionel Richie, the King of Pop himself, Michael Jackson. This song was a fundraiser for Africa's famine relief, but later was revived as a fundraiser for the 2010 earthquake in Haiti.
Here you have it, folks. We are the Rollers written by the Rollers Club Gersell Academy.
Thank you. That brings tears to my eyes. I'm still shaking. That was awesome. Congratulations, Charlotte.
What an excellent performance. Let's give Charlotte one more round of applause. Next, Will Dash, Lucy Jothan, Simon Oliemi, and Gibson McElvain will introduce our 7th grade theater arts performance.
Written in 1969, the poem "I Know Why the Cajun Sings" by Maya Angelou paints a picture of the stark differences between those afforded opportunities in life and those imprisoned by the oppressive effects of racism. Listen to the descriptions of the free birds and all that life offers them in contrast to the narrow, confining world of the caged birds. The caged bird sings not for joy, but as the only resource available to speak out.
The perseverance of the caged bird and its quest for freedom directly reflects Maya Angelou's own life. Growing up in the segregated South and suffering the effects of racism and oppression, she was determined to succeed as an artist, educator, and a civil rights activist. She broke barriers to succeed, to seize opportunities that life gave her. For her work, she was awarded the Presidential Medal of Freedom and was recognized as one of the foremost poets in the world. Maya Angelou was also a performer, a dancer, and studied modern dance with the Gristel Academy's portrait leader, Martha Graham.
The instrumental music played underneath is "Lift Every Voice and Sing," originally written as a poem by James Weldon. It was first recited by 500 school students in Jacksonville, Florida in the 1900s. Later, his brother, J. Wilson Johnson, set the poem to music. It grew in popularity as school children sang it and taught it to others. Within 20 years, it was being sung all over the South within Black American communities and other parts of the country as well. Today, it is being sung all over the world as an anthem of hope and inclusion.
Although written completely separately, the juxtaposition of the poem and music brings two artistic mediums, poetry and music, together to create a powerful performance piece. Throughout time, the arts have often been used as vehicles for expression and change. We hope that the words and music of our 7th grade students will speak to you today.
Wings are clipped, and it's open to the room to sing. things unknown, but long for still. And his tune is heard on the distant hill, for the caged bird sings of freedom.
Good morning, everybody, and thank you for having me. I'm going to talk to you about African-American quilters. We can date back to 1780 as the first quilt that has been preserved. Those quilts were all made out of scraps, which were called scrap quilts. And this quilt shows you what a scrap quilt looks like. If you can see, it's tiny pieces of fabric. It would take the quilter sometime a year to save enough fabric to be able to put the quilt together. They would take fabric from clothing that they made for other people, the scraps that were left, they would gather them up. They would also take feed sacks. The feed came in the bags for the animals. They would take those feed sacks. They would take flour sacks, and they would cut those flour sacks up until they had the fabric they needed. They would then sit and painfully stitch every piece together until they had a quilt large enough to cover them, to keep them warm in the winter. When they started having larger pieces of fabric, they turned the quilt into what is called a crazy quilt. If you look at it, it's crazy. The way everything is laid, it's in different patterns, different sections. But then they would sit with needle and thread and stitch decorative designs on every seam. They did that because it gave them a chance to sit and gossip and have friends and socialize. But once it was done, it also became a bed quilt. And the quilters worked on these continuously. This quilt is called a Bible quilt. And sometimes people call them pictorial quilts because it shows pictures. But what this quilt is, it was made by Harriet Powers, an African-American slave. Once she was freed, she was able to make this quilt in 1886. She displayed this quilt at a fair, and an artist named Jenny Smith came by and saw the quilt. And Jenny Smith wanted to buy the quilt. But Harriet Powers said, "I'll never sell my quilt, no. This is just for my family." But 4 years later, Harriet was so poor, she needed money. Now, Jenny had offered her $10 for the quilt. So she said, "Okay, let me go back to Jenny and see if I could get the $10 for this quilt." But when she went back, Jenny said, "I only have $5. Harriet didn't want to sell the quilt, but she had no choice. So she sold the quilt for $5. But before she let Jenny take possession of the quilt, she made Jenny sit down and document each block of the quilt so that people would know what her story was. This quilt was donated to the Smithsonian Institute at the time of Jenny Smith's death. The Smithsonian has this quilt in their possession now. It is not usually on display. They will bring it out on occasion for fiber arts to type things. Two of made it through. The second quilt is in Boston at the Museum of Art in Massachusetts. Now the next quilts I'm going to talk about are quilts from G's Bend. Now I know that the eighth graders just heard about G's Bend. G's Bend is an island in rural Alabama where it was a plantation. And the slaves who worked the plantation did not leave after the Civil War. They stayed on the island, and when the owner died, he gave them the land. At one point, they ran into financial trouble. So they started making their quilts and selling the quilts in order to maintain their lifestyle. These quilts from G's Bend are one of the most prolific quilts around the country. They are in over 30 different art museums, and they date back from 1897 to the present. So you talk about African American, these are all examples of the G's Bend quilting. African Americans passing down their tradition from generation to generation is not evident so much as it is here at G's Bend. And these are all quilts that show or depict something from the motherland, from Africa. The look of it, the style of it, the feel of it. Okay. Now, this is no longer in the 1800s. This is today. This is my quilting studio. In the old days, the quilters would load their quilts on a wooden frame, and they would sit around the quilt, and they would quilt. Each person would have needle and thread and quilt the quilt. That's called a long arm. It's 14 feet long by 4 feet wide, and I can quilt on that up to a king-size quilt. And I can get it done within 2 or 3 days. When we sat around the frame, it took almost a year to get a quilt quilted. So this is what it looks like today. Okay, and that's just some quilts that I have finished that are on my quilting machine and in my quilt studio. Okay, now how did I become a quilter? It certainly was not passed down in my family. Nobody knew how to quilt. At Thanksgiving, I asked, "Hey, I want to make a quilt. Does anybody know how to quilt?" And all of my siblings said, "Go buy a blanket. You don't need to quilt." So I was like, "No, I'm going to persevere on this." Well, when I started quilting, there was no internet. There was no YouTube. There was no Facebook. So I couldn't ask anybody. But we've always had libraries. So I went to the library. And I found one simple book in the library that said, take one piece of fabric on the top, put some batting in the middle, and a piece of fabric on the bottom, and quilt. Okay, how do you quilt? That didn't tell me. So I went to the encyclopedia. A lot of the kids here may not even know what the encyclopedia is, or haven't seen one. But it was a set of books that went from A through Z. So I grabbed the Q encyclopedia and looked up quilts. The only thing it showed me was a picture of a hand stitching a needle through fabric. So okay, three pieces of items, needle and thread, and a running stitch. I can do that. That was the worst quilt anybody has ever seen. But after that, I met a lady at a supermarket, and this pays to talk to people. So I started talking to her, and she said, oh, I quilt. She said, there's a quilt group in Baltimore. You want to come? So I thought, yeah, I will go with her and a couple quilters. I walked in the room. There were 287 women in this quilt group. Then I found that there were international quilt shows. I have been around the world, around the United States, taking classes, learning, listening, persevering, until I became a professional quilter. You become a professional quilter once you make a sale of either a quilt or you start to teach and make money from quilting. I displayed my quilts at quilt shows, Maryland State Fair will let you display quilts. I have won ribbons, and I have won different awards with quilting. It is one of the most rewarding things I have ever done. After working for Social Security Administration for 38 years, I started a second career. I opened my quilt shop. I started selling quilting items. My quilts were all commissioned, so I had none of them, basically. People would call me and say, can you make me a quilt? Then I would sit with them and I would say, what color do you want? What theme do you want? What is it that you don't like? Because I don't want to put a star on your quilt if you hate a star. So that's how I started to make money from my quilting. And then I moved on to accepting quilt tops from other quilters. They would send me their quilt top. I would supply the batting in the middle. They would send me their backings. I would use my machine to quilt the three layers together, send it back to them for them to close the edging, and that's how I started. And as of now, the only quilting I'm doing right now is for an organization called the Quilts of Valor. This is an organization that makes quilts for veterans. So veterans can go on the website, ask for a quilt, then it's sent out to one of the Quilt of Valor organizations. The one I belong to is in Pennsylvania. So they send us the order, who the veteran is, what their rank, and what branch of service. We make the quilt, and then at special occasions, we present that veteran with the quilt and a thank you for serving the United States. So now I'm going to show you some of my quilts that I have done. This first quilt was an early quilt in the same vein as Harriet Cowell's pictorial quilt. And all quilts are named. So this is called Sisterhood. Turn it around, the front. That one was really early on, and it's all hand quilted. And when you hand quilt, you prick your fingers. I have no more fingerprints left. Because I have stuck my fingers so many times. Okay. The next quilt is a sample of an art quilt. I made this one for a customer to hang in a beach house. Now, just like in paintings and in literature, there are copyright rules in quilting, and you will be sued if you take something that does not belong to you. So Gerstel in kindergarten had students to do a self-portrait. So I got permission from the five-year-old to turn her portrait into a quilt. And here it is. And it hangs on the wall in my house. Do you know who that kindergarten was? Now this next quilt combines, I started dyeing fabric, so I hand dye all of my fabrics now. I don't buy commercial fabric. Combines applique with hand dyed fabrics, and it represented At our house, we have so many birds. They drive me nuts. So I thought I'd just bring a bird in. And that's the full-size bedquilt. It's folded in half. Now, this next quilt represents traveling. I see quilts in everything. When I come in here and look around for stuff, I see stuff on the walls, I see tile, I see everything as a quilt. This quilt is called my travel quilt because when we traveled, I stopped at little marketplaces along the way and I bought molas. The molas are the structured pieces that are in the squares. They're from Cambodia, Panama, Vietnam, and Laos. So when I saw the molas, I immediately saw a quilt. Now the last quilt I'm going to show you is the one I just finished, and it's going to be presented to a veteran as a quilt to battle quilt for their next event. And that's the top. It's a representation of the flag, but yet not the flag. And if you, can you let it down? So every day I drop Kendra at school and I head home and I go in my studio and that's where you'll find me.
Thank you, Ms. Brown, for sharing your time, talents, and treasures with us today. Next, Ms. Quinzer and the middle school students will present their quotes.
Since the early 1800s, the women of G's Bend, Alabama, have transformed worn clothes, sacks, and other fabric remnants into patterns that surpass the boundaries of quilting. The area was named after Joseph G., a landowner who established a cotton plantation in 1816 with his 17 slaves. After emancipation, many freed slaves and their families stayed on the In the 1930s, G's Bend faced many problems due to mechanized farming practices, but many inhabitants remained, and with them remained their quilting tradition. Today, the town remains in poverty and isolated, with a population of under 300, many of which have to drive over 50 miles just to find employment. Many residents in the community can trace their ancestry back to the original Petway plantation, and their quilting tradition has been passed down from generation to generation. For hundreds of years, these women have come together creating abstract designs and telling stories. These patterns and piecing styles have survived slavery, the antebellum South, and Jim Crow. Burdened by decades of sharecropping and racial discrimination, G's Bend quilters seized an opportunity to use their artistry for empowerment in 1965. Prior to this, many members of the community were not registered voters. But in 1965, a visit from Dr. Martin Luther King inspired them. He spoke to the people of the community and encouraged them to march to a nearby town. He encouraged them to register to vote. He wrote, "I came over here to G's Bend to tell you, you are somebody." Inspired by Dr. King's visit, the residents defied local authorities who were trying to prevent them from registering to vote. During this time, an old mule named Bell played a crucial role. When law enforcement shut down the ferry that connected G's Bend to the polling station, Bell helped transport voters to the polls using wagons. Bell became a symbol of resilience and determination, showing that even an old mule could be a hero. Many of those who marched and voted lost their jobs, but nonetheless, they persevered. After Dr. King's assassination, Bell and another mule, Ada, were chosen to pull his casket in the funeral procession in Atlanta. Their steadfastness and unwavering commitment mirrored the determination of the G's Bend community. The story of Bell and the people of G's Bend served as a powerful reminder of courage and resilience displayed during the civil rights movement. Their actions contributed to the fight for justice and equality, even in the face of adversity. Determined to live more of an equal society, as well as provide for their families, more than 60 quilters from G's Bend created a partnership called the Freedom Quilting Bee, which served as a way for these women to make money and gain economic independence. The Bee Cooperative began to sell quilts throughout the U.S., gaining recognition for the free-form, seemingly improvisational designs that had long been the hallmark of local quilt designing. This cooperative championed the vision and production of G's Bend quilters in national art auctions, commercial partnerships, and museums. Within 3 years, their ingenuity helped these quilters purchase washing machines, automobiles, school supplies, telephone lines, and electricity. A tradition that started out of necessity has now been recognized in the art world. With the help of the Souls Grown Deep Foundation, quilters such as Loretta Pedway now have quilts hanging in museums like the Metropolitan Museum of Art and the Baltimore Museum of Art. These quilts are widely recognized for their abstract geometric patterns and vibrant colorways. Students in middle school spent time learning about the community of G's Bends. They then were able to create their own class quilts using the same geometric patterns that many of the G's Bend quilters follow. Each student created their own square, which was then attached to make a full quilt. I and Jalen hold the 8th grade quilt, Parker, Andre, David, and Tristan hold the 6th grade quilt, and Nina and Reed represent the 5th grade. By creating their own versions of these quilts, students came to recognize that the quilts of G's Bend have been a beloved, important chapter in the history of American art, as well as how this small community of G's Bend played a huge role in the civil rights movement through their love and tradition of art. Thank you. Next, please welcome our Upper School National Art Honor Society members as they present to us about the Harlem Renaissance and its significant artists.
Good morning. My name is Elaine Casey, and I serve as the president of the Cristel Academy chapter of the National Art Honor Society. The NAHS student members are very excited to bring you our presentation about the unique and electrifying historical period, artists, and artwork of African-American art known as the Harlem Renaissance. Next to present is Morgan Burns.
Back in the beginning years of the 20th century, from 1917 to the 1940s, a great wave of mass migration saw more than 5 million African-Americans move from their homes in southern states to large urban cities in the north, like New York City, Chicago, Detroit, and Philadelphia. Even Baltimore, which was referred to as the Upsouth, was a destination. Why were so many African Americans moving to large cities during the 20th century? Well, they wanted to escape segregation, discrimination, and violence for sure, but they also wanted more social and economic opportunities. They wanted a better life. One destination that was particularly popular was the area called Harlem in Manhattan, New York City, Our next presenter is Ruby Conley.
The African Americans who moved north brought their intelligence, skills, passions, and artistic talents with them. It was the dawn of the jazz age, and as music, art, and literature converged with this great migration, the Harlem Renaissance was born. It was an explosion of cultural, social, intellectual, and artistic expression rooted in the Black experience. African American poets, writers, musicians, and visual artists flocked to Harlem, making it a mecca for new ideas, art, and sounds to be expressed. The Harlem Renaissance is one of the most significant eras of African American history. Peyton Costin will present next. Jazz musicians like Jelly Roll Morton and Fats Waller, singers such as Billie Holiday and Bessie Smith, writers like Zora Neale Hurston and Gwendolyn Bennett gave new vibrant voice to African Americans. They were joined by visual artists like Aaron Douglas, Augustus Savage, and Jacob Lawrence, who created new art forms to delight the minds and eyes of viewers. In this presentation, we will offer you a look at the dynamic artwork of these three Harlem Renaissance artists who helped to usher in this special golden age. The next presenter is Elaine Casey.
Aaron Douglas, who lived from 1899 to 1979, is considered the father of modern African American art. He defined a modern visual language that represented Black Americans in a new light. Douglas began his career as a landscape painter, but was influenced by some of the modern art movements such as Cubism. In Cubism, the subjects in an artwork appear fragmented and fractured. He was influenced by the up-and-coming graphic arts, which used bold colors and stylized forms. But along with these very modern influences, Douglas looked toward the art of West Africa for inspiration too. The traditional art from Africa connected him and his viewers to their African heritage. He broke ground for other Black artists. Let's take a closer look at some of his awesome artworks. Now we'll hear from Matthew Felicia.
This oil painting, titled Into Bondage, was created in 1936. Let's take a close look at this artwork. Into Bondage is a powerful depiction of enslaved Africans bound for the Americas. Shackled figures with their heads hung low walk solemnly toward slave ships on the horizon. Yet even in this grave image of oppression, there is hope. In a gesture foreshadowing freedom from slavery, a lone woman at left raises her bound hands, guiding the viewer's eyes to the ships. The male figure in the center pauses and turns his face towards a beam of light coming from a star in the softly colored sky, perhaps suggesting the North Star. The man's strong silhouette communicates strength and optimism. See the concentric circles surrounding the sun? Douglas often used this motif to suggest sound. Here, he is referring to African song. Lydia Leffert is next.
This painting by Douglas reads like a sentence. Starting on the left, he shows the slave and southern life of the African American. They work in the fields, picking cotton, and above them are hooded figures on horses. The figures to the right of them turn their heads in the other direction, looking towards new opportunities and listening to new messages about civil rights. On the right is a jazz musician and a dancer, indicating the new life in New York City. The people are in silhouettes, which was a signature aspect to Douglas's work. A silhouette could represent everyone and was an influence on American art. Again, the concentric circles represent sounds or songs. Next to present is Grace Watson.
Another famous Harlem Renaissance artist was Augustus Savage, who lived from 1892 to 1962. Although she was one of the few female Harlem Renaissance artists, she was well known in Harlem as a sculptor, art teacher, and community art program director. Savage grew up in Florida, but eventually made her way to New York City with $4.60 in her pocket. She was resourceful by finding a job as an apartment caretaker and took action by enrolling at the Cooper Union School of Art, where she completed the 4-year course in 3 years. In 1932, Savage established the Savage Studio of Arts and Crafts and became an influential art teacher in Harlem, affecting the lives of many young African Americans. Savage is best known for her sculptural portraits of African Americans, whether prominent or just an average African American person. The next presenter is Cal Rudick.
Created in 1929, Gaiman was a critical artwork not only to Savage's career, but also as a wonderful example of the Harlem Renaissance's mission. The representation of the solemn, sensitive youth expressed the inborn dignity of African-American identity that many black artists of the time wanted to promote. Wearing a bebop cap with its wide brim cocked jauntily to the side, the figure tilts its head in the same direction and looks past the observer with a slightly inquisitive expression of a typical boy. The sculpture was modeled in clay, cast in plaster, and painted. Notice the sensitive modeling of the boy's broad features, deeply set eyes, and prominent ears that Savage did. And the open collar of his wrinkled shirt and crumpled cap add to the sculpture's informality and charm. The subject for the sculpture happens to be her nephew. For the sculpture, Savage was awarded a Julius Rosenwald Fellowship to study in Paris in 1929. Many African-American Harlem Renaissance artists studied in Paris, where they encountered less bias and prejudice. Becca Sprinkle will speak next.
One of Augustus Savage's best-known sculptures was this one, titled The Harp. It was commissioned by the New York World's Fair of 1939 to create a sculpture symbolizing the musical contributions of African Americans. African American spirituals and hymns were the forms Savage decided to symbolize in the harp. Savage was inspired by the lyrics of James Weldon Johnson's poem, "Lift Every Voice and Sing," and wanted to represent the meaning of the song in her sculpture. The harp was Savage's largest work and most major commission. She spent almost 2 years completing the 16-foot sculpture, cast in plaster, and finished to resemble black basalt. The harp was exhibited in the Court of Contemporary Arts building at the World's Fair, where it received much acclaim. The sculpture depicted a group of 12 stylized black singers in graduated heights, and that symbolized the strains of the harp. The sounding board was formed by the hand and arm of God, and a kneeling man holding music represented the bell pedal. Morgan Burns follows next.
The last Harlem Renaissance artist we will present today is Jacob Lawrence, and he is probably the most well-known. Lawrence lived from 1917 until 2000. The son of migrant workers from the South who moved north for a better life for their family. While Lawrence is generally part of the list of prominent Harlem Renaissance artists, he is also often referred to as a social protest artist. This was an art style that was concerned with calling attention to the social, economic, and political problems of the day. His goal was that through his paintings, he could give voice to the experiences of his people. He was a visual storyteller who used vibrant patterns, blocks of strong color, and simplified angular figures and forms to create powerful images. Throughout his career, the subject matter of his paintings ranged from neighborhood life to the experiences of black industrial laborers to the civil rights movement. Lawrence was a popular artist for all people, regardless of their race. He was a significant American artist who influenced many, many artists in his life and well beyond his years on Earth. Ruby Conley will now present.
One of Lawrence's most ambiguous art projects was a narrative painting series called The Migration of the Negro, which included 60 paintings. He was only 23 years old when he started the series. Through these paintings, Lawrence depicted the sorrows and joys of African Americans in the early 20th century as they moved from the South to the North. This painting is one of the paintings in the Migration series. It has a long title or caption, "They arrived in Pittsburgh, one of the great industrial centers of the North, in large numbers." Here, Lawrence shows two families who are looking out the window at the train they are riding to their northern destination, Pittsburgh.
He shows the smokestacks of industrial plants through the window. The people lean toward the window, gesturing and looking excitedly at the future they imagine. Mothers hold infants, dressed in white, and a basket of food sits between the families, symbolizing the bounty that awaits them in their new life. Lawrence reduced the figures to simple shapes and was not concerned with portraying realistically. He distilled everything into an easily understood story. Peyton Costin is next to present. In his later art career, Lawrence turned to printmaking. This print is called The Library, and once again, Lawrence showed his signature style of reducing people and objects to their simplest form. He adds vibrant colors for an energetic and engaging artwork. Lawrence captured both the joys and the struggles of this era. He used bold primary colors, abstract shapes, and striking compositions to tell these stories in a clear and captivating way. Lawrence acquired a significant achievement. In 1942, with segregation in full force, Lawrence broke a racial barrier by becoming the first African-American artist whose work was acquired to the Museum of Modern Art in New York City. One of his paintings is also in the White House art collection. Through his vivid, accessible visual storytelling, Lawrence presented the richness and complexities of African-American history and culture both to his own community and the larger world. Now Grace Monson will present.
Members of the National Art and Arts Society hope you enjoyed learning a bit about the Harlem Renaissance, one of the most significant times in African-American history. We also hope you enjoyed seeing a few of the artworks from three of the most important African-American artists of the Harlem Renaissance. Thank you for your attention.
Good morning. My name is Greg Hammond. As one of the most prolific jazz composers, pianists, and band leaders in history, and an originator of big band music, Duke Ellington wrote thousands of pieces during his 50-year career. This piece includes some well-known works, Take the A-Train, Don't Get Around Much Anymore, Mood Indigo, Caravan, and A Don't Mean a Thing. Join us back in the 1930s and 40s as we conclude our ceremony with Duke Ellington in concert.
And being master of the ceremonies. To Lower School, thank you so much for your beautiful performance of We Are the World. Thank you for your wonderful baton twirling, Charlotte Willis. It was very entertaining. Seventh grade students, thank you for sharing I Know Why the Caged Bird Sings. Thank you, Upper School National Art Honor Society, for the Harlem Renaissance presentation and its significant artists. upper school band, your Duke Ellington in concert was beautiful. Thank you for sharing it with us. Big thanks to Mrs. Brown for being generous with the time, talents, and treasures today. Thank you to all of our student speakers and presenters. Mrs. Borgo would like to thank our arts department. Thank you for all of your hard work, Ms. Kaysner, Ms. Polash, Mrs. Estes, Mr. Reed, and last but certainly not least, Mrs. Daly. I want to thank the IT department and social media for all of your perseverance in ensuring that everything was ready to be presented today, including the music. So, let's thank Mr. Samuel, Ms. Jodin, Ms. Molesworth, and Mr. Stem. Felicity's department, thank you for setting up and breaking down everything today. Thank you, Mrs. McCann, Mrs. Edwards, and Ms. Quinzer for helping us create the beautiful quilts that were presented today. Volunteers, thank you for holding up the quilts. Mrs. Warga, thank you for planning this assembly, and Mrs. Sprinkle, thank you for helping with the details. Administrators, thank you for your support. Lastly, I would like to thank Dr. Smith, Mr. Palasco, and Mrs. Luke. Thank you for your consistent support with having the annual Black History Month assembly. Thank you to everyone for being such a great audience. I hope you all enjoy the rest of your day. Now, please stand and join us in singing the Gerstel Academy alma mater.